Wildlife is becoming one of the main paths toward development of the world's poorest countries. And we, the inhabitants of the first world, must lead the way in laying the groundwork. On Ngamba Island, a sanctuary for chimpanzees financed by foundations and tourism from Europe, America, and Asia, has turned into a driving force for the economy of many surrounding islands.
We have a community development program where we have set up a program called Sustainable Living on Lake Victoria. And this is, we are on an island, and Ngamba Island chimpanzee sanctuary is just only for the chimpanzees, but there are other islands neighboring Ngamba Island. And for the people to appreciate, you know, why the chimpanzees should be there on Ngamba Island, you know, and not be able to, you know, feel aggressive and, you know, kill them if they see them at the shores of the lake. We have developed this program, which is, you know, which is supporting them. We have built primary schools, and we have a total of 168 children who were not going to school, who are now going to school. We have supported other primary schools in other communities on different islands, also with scholastic materials. We have built accommodation for the teachers, and they see that, you know, it's because of the existence of Ngamba Island that they have been able to get that support. And in addition to that, we also do public health and sanitation awareness. You know, we go out and teach them basic hygiene. We organize workshop with the community leaders, with the school teachers, and all that. And the communities around Ngamba Island all associate that to the existence of the chimpanzees at the sanctuary. They understand that if the chimpanzees were not there, they wouldn't be getting all those benefits. So the reality is there, that, you know, there is a big conflict between humans and the wildlife across the countries in Africa. And to me, from my experience, since I've been working in wildlife for the last 10 years, the case studies we have had in Uganda, you know, of the communities getting direct benefit has helped very much, and the communities would be supportive so long as they see direct benefit, you know, to their livelihood.
The Ngamba Island project follows the guidelines of the Jane Goodall Institute. After spending her entire life studying and protecting the chimpanzees and their habitat, Jane Goodall used her knowledge and experience to create and head up Roots and Shoots, a conservationist movement dedicated to the education and development of local communities.
Roots and Shoots is my passion because I could kill myself working to protect chimpanzees and forests. But if we're not educating young people to do a better job than we've done, what's the point? I work and work and work, we'll save a forest, and the next generations will cut it down. So Roots and Shoots is symbolic. Roots make a firm foundation. Shoots seem tiny. To reach the sun, they can break through a brick wall. You imagine the brick wall as all the bad things we've done to the planet, environmental and social. Hope, you see, hundreds and thousands of young people together around the world can break through and make this a better world for all living things. Mm-hmm. So the most important message, every individual makes a difference every day. That's you and me, all the young people, everybody.
All conservationists who work in the field, in the last wildlife sanctuaries, have reached the same conclusions. They know that the greatest danger is posed by those who ignore these situations. Or at the other end of the spectrum, those who throw in the towel, convinced that they are powerless in the face of such complex and far-off problems.
I think the world is moving to a situation now where green issues, where issues of conservation and issues of the way that we treat the planet are becoming more and more important. We all know about global warming, we all know about deforestation, we all know about the glaciers melting and the potential impact that's going to have on everybody that lives in the world. What happens in Africa, what happens in South America, what happens in a lot of these countries will have an impact on people living in Europe, people living in America, people living in wherever people live in the world. And ultimately, you know, if we don't start looking after this planet properly and more sustainably, we're all going to suffer. And interestingly, what's happening here is just a microcosm. It's a small part of what potentially could happen all over northern Kenya. It could happen all over northern Africa. It could happen in the Congo, where at the moment there's a civil war. And if it did happen, it's going to be beneficial for the rest of the world. And so, you know, people may sit at home and say, there's nothing that I can do. I see the, you know, rhinos are poached for their horns, or chimpanzees are killed for bushmeat. But there is something they can do, because, as I said earlier, you know, the destruction of the rainforest in West Africa, for example, is a consequence of demand for African hardwood in Europe, America, and the Far East. Well, if that demand was stopped, if that demand was halted, if people instead were prepared to use other materials for building or for furniture or whatever, and the destruction of the West African rainforest was stopped as a consequence, it is likely that chimpanzees would continue to exist and probably would start to increase in number again. But the other benefit of that would be that the rainforest itself would remain intact. And the benefit of that is it would help to potentially slow down the effects of global warming, which are currently a major threat facing the planet. So everybody has a role to play. And I think importantly, I think people are beginning to understand that. Not so much the older generation, but the younger generation.
A reproduction of the Tsingy Peaks is bringing the delicate beauty of Madagascar to the Spanish public at Biopark. The role of zoos as educational centers does not consist solely of speaking to the public about the problems facing different species and their ecosystems. Here, they also make an effort to show the various projects taking place all over the world that are beginning to have an effect. Many animal species, like the Père David's deer, the European and American bison, the Przewalski's horse, the scimitar-horned oryx, various species of lemur, and many more, have been brought back from the brink of extinction through the hard work of zoological institutes. The economic backing from the park's foundations that make on-site conservation programs possible comes in large part from visitors to these zoos. The money is going to ensure the protection of more land, the education of local populations, and the possibility of progress through wild areas. All this is the result of an educational campaign that is starting to make an impression on future generations.
Well, I have to be optimistic, and I think there's reason to be optimistic. If you look at the history of what we've done in the last 100 years, and certainly what we've done in the last 20 years, the amount of wild lands and wild habitats we've been able to set aside and preserve, working with local people and local governments in different parts of the world where these lands and these animals were really, really in danger. You have to be optimistic.
Really, the only utopia that remains is to change people's mentality, educate them. Society is taking a different path. Society is uneducating people, doling out more and more information, but less knowledge. And I think that this park is a place where people can have a seat and begin to value things slowly, which is the definition of knowledge. But that having been said, while we are helping people to become more conscientious, which is going to take a while, it makes sense to open the zoo's doors and aid in conservation efforts. How? providing funds. Nowadays, we can't do any more than that, providing funds to organizations that are already on the front lines of conservation in Africa, conserving tropical rainforests, and following their lead.